Hello guys, so today we have the lecture on ImageJ. It is the one of the most used applications in the science world. So what is cool about it, it's made by scientists for scientists. So as you can see from this explanation, it was developed by National Institute of Health, so NIH, and if you Google ImageJ, it will tell you the belonging to NIH. So you click on it, and here you can see the main page. So you can download from here, and it actually gives you the first version of this cool application. But we are going to use one that is more advanced. So first, let me tell you about the ImageJ. So it is the open source program, and open source means that you can easily inspect the code, change what you don't want to have, and even add some more code to kind of advance the experience from using this program. So if you want to use the previous version, go to downloads from here, and it's really easy to do. By the way, if you are going to use the previous version based on today's video, you will still be able to do that because it's compatible. I mean, the actions that I'm going to perform today, they are totally compatible in the previous version. So what I want you to do is go to links here, and from these links you see the software that is based on ImageJ. So all these can be used by yourself in the lab, and if you excel the knowledge in one of these places, you will be a valuable person in the lab for sure. So from this list, I was using, for example, MBF, and it is McMaster Biophotonics Facility. They created a very good distribution of ImageJ first version. I was using it for about a year, but then I switched to Fiji because Fiji now has the development team that creates better plugins for the new version of ImageJ. And ImageJ new version is ImageJ 2, so you can click from here both of these links. So here you have the wiki page of the ImageJ 2, and also you can see what are different stuff that is changed. First of all, it's actually the engine, and by using this new engine, the whole experience became more smooth and nice for newcomers. Okay, so here you can read that Fiji is actually using the new version for a long time, and they are actually creating much of the stuff that is going to be implemented in this ImageJ 2 version. Okay, so instead of downloading this ImageJ 2, we go to Fiji, and from here you have this Fiji project. It gets you to the main page. You could also do the search in the Google. So if you scroll down a little, you will see this fiji.sc, or you can go from the links page. So when you get here, you have the option to download it straight away, but also you can click on this arrow and it will tell you which versions it has also. So there is a version for macOS and for Linux distributions. So if you are using Windows on 32-bit system, you're going to choose this one. I actually need the 64-bit version, and I had downloaded it already. So you can open it. So it's a zip file. You don't need WinRAR for this one. The usual archive programs, they can easily extract the zip files. So here you see the Fiji app folder. Let's say that we have our microscopy folder. We could extract it straight away, and without waiting for installation, it's ready to be executed. So open this Fiji folder and scroll down. Here you see this executable file called ImageJ2. So double click on it, and first run it will ask you to update all the plugins and launcher. So I would recommend that you do that, because the experience that you obtain from the newest versions is of course the best. Okay, so now it tells you that it's installed, and because I had it on my computer before, all the libraries were updated, but you will see something like a pop-up window saying that the updater is ran now, and they ask you to update it or remind you later. Do the update, because it doesn't take much time. So here you see the window of ImageJ or Fiji, and Fiji is the abbreviation, and the explanation of this abbreviation is like this: Fiji. So F goes for Fiji, I goes for is just ImageJ. Of course, from this part, Fiji again is Fiji is just ImageJ, and it goes eternal times, and it is the recurrent function. So this is a general joke for the open source programs. You will see them a lot if you start doing some stuff in open source, and of course they did it here too, so it's quite funny. So what we do now, we need to talk about the interface. So here you see the command line or the menu line. So you have files here, you can see all the familiar stuff that you could see in other programs too. Then we switch to edit, also very familiar to other image editors, and the fun starts here. So from image, so we can tweak the image. So let's say we have 32-bit, and we can convert it to 8-bit, 16-bit, RGB, RGB stack, etc. We could also change the brightness and contrast in adjust menu. We can do all the color balancing, thresholds, size tweaks, etc. So we could also go to properties, and the properties of the images, because it's in the image menu. So if you open the image, so let's say we take give me a second. Okay, so here we have the PCR gel image. By pressing on Control and rotating the mouse wheel, you can zoom in and zoom out, so it kind of creates better experience too. So we could go back to images and set properties. Okay, so in this properties window, you can set up the pixel width and height. So it actually tells you the physical sizes of your pixels. So for now, let's go further. So we have the color menu, and here you could split the channels, merge channels, arrange channels, etc. So you could also make your stack look like RGB, and so on and so forth. Let's actually have one example of RGB picture. So this cat is RGB image, it's in here. We see the dimension of this image. So usually in the right top part of the window, you see the main properties. So by clicking on this window with the image, you choose properties and see, well, not much going on here. So let's say that we want to split the channels. Because it's RGB, it will be split into red, green, blue. So split image. So red, green, and blue. So green, red, blue. Okay, so if you want to make some enhancements on these channels, you can absolutely do that. So let's say that you want to create more reddish image. For that, you're going to press Shift C, and in this case, you're given the option to change the brightness and contrast. You could also go from Image, Adjust, Brightness and Contrast. Okay, so by choosing the red window, we are going to enhance it. So again, press on the window that you want to work with, and then Shift C. So what you could do, you could increase it a little, I mean the brightness and contrast. You could also change these values here. So the maximum will be 255 because it's 8-bit RGB image. So you could oversaturate some of the pixels that are above 224 grayscales. And in this case, you increase the redness of this image. So let's say that we press apply. Now this part, I mean this channel of red, has more skewed pixels towards the red values, okay? So what we do now, we press on image, then we have the colors and merge channels. So what you do, well, because we split it before, now the program knows what to do. So it sets the red, green channel as a green image and blue as the blue image. So we could keep the source images, we could create composite. So these two parts always should be on, because sometimes you might mess up with the composite, so you just close it. And without having changed the original source images, you just create another one. Okay, so what we do, we press OK here, and we have more reddish cat. And if you want to compare it to the previous version, it was looking like this. We could also increase green or blue, so whichever is fine for you. So let's do that. So instead of increasing red now, we add some warm green color. So what we do, we press on this image, then Shift C and increase it a little. So 225 is also the same. Press apply and then color merge channels. Okay, now we have more green, and if you take the more red, so now you see that it is warmer now than it was before. Now why it happens? Because our eye is more seeing more green, and usually the green colors are making more contrast for our vision. Okay, so on these composites, you have also the right top box, which tells you the information about the image. And the cool stuff here is actually that it shows the channel that you are working with now. So it's red now, and it means that we are in the red channel of this composite image. You could also see this scroll bar, and it scrolls between these three channels. So first is red, then we have green, and finally we have the blue channel. So what we could do, we could enhance our channels from this composite without going back to the original files and without actually changing them. So now in this original triple file, I have enhanced and applied enhancement of the original files, but We don't have to do that because we could just create the composite from the original, and then in the channels you just press Shift C and you see the histogram that you are going to work with. So the channel is green now, that's why the histogram is green. If we change it to red, the histogram also changes, and finally blue. So let's say that you want to get this image without changing the green channel from the previous composite file. It's really easy. So as far as I remember, we were using 225, and if we go down to 225 grayscale values in the green channel, we actually obtain the same image. So this is the power of this tool, which could be used to enhance different channels separately. So now we are in blue, and now let's remove some blue from the picture. So let's say that we remove all pixels in blue that are below 70 grayscales. I will explain what you actually do, but it is the enhancement. So now it seems more green than before, because we did remove the blue pixels. If we change the maximum value here, as we did in the previous one, it means that we lighten the dark or low grayscale values, and we stretch them to the highest values that are possible. So I will tell you what it means. So if you go with this bar here, you could actually see that it goes blue more and more, right? So what happens here? We have this grayscale histogram for the blue channel. So here, let's draw the same one. And let's say it looked like this. So what it means? It means that in the blue channel we have pure black and pure white parts. So because it's 8-bit, we go from 0 to 255. Why it goes 255? Because the 8-bit information looks like this. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 bits. Okay? Each bit could take the value of 1 or 0. And that's why it's called binary. So we have only two possible values. Okay, so this is the 8-bit information about the black color. So what is the 8-bit information about the white color? It's 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay, so this is pure white. This is pure black. Okay, so in between we have how many of the values. It's really easy to calculate because we have eight possible positions, and we have only two possible values. We go 2 as the base and 8 as the power. Okay, so 2 to the power of 8 is 256, but because we have the first value of all zeros, we count 0 to 255. So 0 is the value 2. It's kind of including these guys. And because we include them, the total amount of them is 256. Okay, so this is the 8-bit image, and we have this 8-bit distribution of the pixels. So the grayscales here are from 0 to 255, and if you take each of these, so let's say 1, 2, 3, etc., so we have the number of pixels that have the value of 1, then we have the number of pixels with a value of 2, finally we have the number of pixels with a value of 3. So here you have the number of pixels, okay? And This histogram is shown as the numbers of pixels with such values of the grayscale, okay? So from this part you can understand that we have three ranges with highest numbers. So let's say that here and here, so we have very black colors here, then we have middle gray in this peak, and finally we have a lot of white pixels very close to pure white. So what we speak about now is blue color here. Of course I draw it in a wrong way, so we have also a huge peak here at pure white. Okay, so what it means when we change the minimum and maximum values. So what we do, if we change the minimum on this guy here, or we change the maximum, we cut everything that are above for maximum and cut everything that is below for minimum. So let's say that we chose 70, value of 70 grayscales, okay? So it means that we cut everything on this image that is below 70. So we remove this huge peak. And what it means, it doesn't mean that it all disappears. It means that our new zero value will become at the level of 70. So now what we have a new grayscale, which is from 0 to 255, so pure white and pure black, but we cut it at 70. So we kind of stretch the whole histogram here that is left after cutting to 256 values. So what we have now would be looking like this. So we don't have this huge peak here. And of course the pixels that seemed bright, so 70 is quite bright, right? So now they became black. So we moved them towards black value. If we change the maximum, so we remove some of the maximum pixels, so let's say that we dropped it here, so it's 200. So if we removed all pixels above 200, we artificially increased the brightness here. So now, so after we've done minimum and maximum enhancement, we have a totally new histogram that is again stretched from 0 to 255, and it will look like this peak only. So now we kind of made these 200 grayscales look like 255. That's why we increase or make it brighter when we change these two guys, okay? So you can see that 70, right? 70 and 200. So we can press on this set. And go from 70 to 200. So the values in the original image that are below 70, they will become black at all. And the values that are above 200, they will become white, pure white. So now you should see a lot of, so let's say this part, of course it's white, and now it will look oversaturated, so we lose a lot of details, okay? So most probably these parts will go away. As you see, a lot of pixels became pure black and a lot of pixels became pure white, and if you add some coloring, of course this whitish part will become blue and the black part will stay black. Okay, so this is how to work with brightness and contrast. So you see that we could set the values, and before you apply, you can change everything. So let's say that we don't want to see a lot of oversaturated stuff, so let's say 235, and now we actually see a lot of details appearing back. And after we play press apply, it will recalculate our new histogram. So this part that I was drawing here, I was kind of applying these changes of minimum and maximum values. So the same happens here, so you press apply, and now your histogram is stretched. So the part in between these two values is stretched to the whole grayscales. Okay, so this is how to work with this tool. So I don't want to save it because I don't want to mess up my original file. Oops. So I don't save it. Close it. Okay, now let's talk about this gel, because you might be working with a lot of gels. So why this ImageJ is so cool for gel stuff? We can actually do a lot of analysis of the gel. First of all, let's perform the same enhancement. So let's say that we remove or make it more visible now. So here you see wells, and you're going to count from the well, right? So you want to see these wells. Okay, so let's say that 26,500 is enough for me now. And from this part, you can see that it is actually a 16-bit camera, and we have the physical values of the pixels here. So because the gel dock that was used to take this image, it is coming from North America, they are using inches, but you can easily calculate the pixel sizes in millimeters. So what you do, you take your calculator and perform the calculations. So you know that inch is 2.54 centimeters. So we want to calculate the height of this image. So we multiply it by 1082, and we obtain how many centimeters in the height of this image. You could also see the number of pixels. So what you could do now, you could have these 27 centimeters divided by 1039 pixels, and now you obtain the physical size of one pixel. So centimeters is the 10 millimeters, so in millimeters it will look like this, and still it's not the same as we wanted, so let's make them in microns. So we times it 1000, so it's one pixel here is equal to 264.5 microns. So why you want to do that is because you could set the scale. So again, you press on analysis, then you go to set scale, and here you have distance in pixels. Okay, so I know that one pixel is 264.5 microns, so we set one pixel equal to 264. Okay, so it's not point here, like this, and it's not in inches, it's actually in microns. And if you want to choose global, and it will make the Fiji assume all of the pictures that you are going to use today with these dimensions. So I wanted to have only related to this gel image, so I uncheck the global option. I press OK, And now it knows the values in microns. Okay, why do you want to do that? Actually, microns are too high. I mean, too much. So let's make it in millimeters. And in millimeters, or we know that 1 pixel is 0, 2, 6, 4, 5, 12. Okay, now it's much better. So what you could do here, you could check the you could choose the line option here. So it's a tool that shows the lines. So here is the bottom of the well, and we go through our gel. Why you would want to have it? Because here in analyze again, you can choose the plot profile, and it will have the profile of every single pixel, starting from the beginning of this line to the end. So somewhere in the middle, you should have the 2 pixels. So you press on the plot profile, and you actually see that there are 2 pixels of your bands. So let's say that you are going to publish this gel in the paper. So you cannot use something like, "Oh, I can clearly see 2 bands." You should show the bands with the values of intensity. So what else you could do? You could see how many bands you have on this part. So the first line, and the first line shows the number of standard ladders band, and we could go like this. Why I go closer to the edge? Because on the edges we have the brightest parts of the bands. So we go to analyze, plot profile again, and here you can see that we have these peaks. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and small 8. How many bands you see with your eyes? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and now you have the proof that there are actually 8 bands. Okay, sometimes when you know the concentration of the ladder, well, in the description of the ladder, you should be able to obtain the concentrations, and by knowing these concentrations, you could check this band here and identify the intensity. Then you're going to check the same size of your unknown band and calculate, because of the intensity, calculate the concentration of DNA in this band. But of course, it depends on the type of the research that you do. Okay, so what else you could do here? I've shown you all the color stuff that you want to split and merge. Okay, so a lot of stuff could be found here. Again, when you set the scale, you now could choose the tools part and choose the scale bar. It will show you the scale bar on the needed part of your image. So here you have the options. So let's say that you want to show 40 millimeters. For the height, because the image might be very small in your paper, you would want to choose different sizes of this bar so it will be visible. So let's say 15 or even 20. The font size is also critical, but sometimes you want to hide your text. You could also choose different fonts and different places. So you could do the upper right, lower left, upper left. Usually it's lower right, but you could also choose your place of the of the gray scales. So you have selected some part and then do the tools scale bar. From here you do the add selection. Because I chose a random part, it shows its size. You could change it to whatever you want, so 40 with a 20. And because it's white here, because the background is black here, we don't choose the background, but for colored pictures you might want to have the background to show. So let's say that we choose black and white here. As you can see, the contrast shows better how much is this bar. Okay, so instead of this one, I chose this lower right. I press OK, and if I'm ready with this image, I can choose File, Save As, and then choose whichever option is fit for me. So if you don't have the possibility to choose TIFF, the best one for the papers would be PNG file. So you choose PNG and you save it as PNG. Okay, now when you open the PNG file, it shows these enhancements that you did. Okay, so this is the part about the scale bar. Okay, so what else? Why this tool is very powerful? I mean the ImageJ, because you have plugins here. So when you press on plugins, you have the macros section, shortcuts, other utilities that you want to use, and then the choice of installation of plugins. You can go to the official site of Fiji or ImageJ, download the plugins from this site, install them, and then use them. So for now, in the standard distribution of Fiji, we have these all plugins, and for each of them on Fiji site you have the whole explanation of the functions and how you perform them. So if you think that it is overwhelming, no, of course not, because you don't use all of these plugins, you use a bunch of them. So what you do, you go to your Fiji file, Fiji page, and from here you see the wiki page, and you go to learn. From this learn you can see the plugins, and from available plugins here you see the list of all plugins that come in the standard edition. So let's say you have one that you want to use, and here you have the whole explanation of everything that is related to this plugin. Okay, so it is about the plugins. Now let's say that we have the Z stack of the images. So in this case, I'm using the previous year's images. So here we have all these images taken on the Zeiss microscope. And to open this series of images, we don't need actually to choose them all. We choose the first one because they differ only by this number at the end, and the ImageJ will understand that, okay, so this is something that I should work with. So you drop this file, and here in this open window, I mean the dialog box, you should choose the option that is most appropriate for you. So by having your mouse over each of these options, in the right window you can see what is the explanation for this option. Because we have the same naming of the file that is different by the number, we should check this box, so it will open the file and create a hyperstack. Then we want to open these files individually and have them all as a series. So press OK, and you see that we have the number of images 15, and here also see 15. You press OK here, and it starts opening this huge stack. Okay, so here we have these Z stacks that goes from the first image up to 15. And we also have two channels. So this is red and this must be green. Okay, so what I do next, because it's the Z stack and we have focus on different cuts of this moss leaf, we could actually create the 3D representation. Oops. So what we do, we go to image, then choose stack, and from here we have the 3D project. So you press on it. We could choose the axis of rotation, so for X axis, because it is X like this, so the rotation will happen in this direction. So let me draw it first. Okay, so the rotation might happen in three different axes, across three different axis. So we have X, Y, and Z. So if the rotation happens in the X axis, it will go like this. In the Y, it will go like that. And in Z, it will go like this. So I will show all of these options. For now, let's choose the axis X. So again, it will move like this. So what is the spacing between slices? As far as I remember, it was 2.5 microns, and here we have 2.5. So what is the initial degree and the last degree? So how many rotations you want to have? So of course I want to go from 0, and let's say I want 10 rotations, so it's 36 hundredths. So the rotation angle shows, so one frame will be rotated how many degrees. So I want to go 10, it's fine. So the total amount of images that I will have is 360. So what else we have? So anything else is kind of okay for us, so we leave it as it is and press OK. So here you can see the progress bar, so it goes up to 360 images. And I actually forgot to merge the channel so that we see the colored representation of the leaf. We will do that in a few minutes. Here you can see that it actually goes twice because we have two channels, and if we had the combined stack, I mean the merged channels stack, it would go only once. So you will see how it looks in both of the channels. Okay, so here you have the split channels representation of this 3D rotation. As you remember, it was in the X, across X axis. So when you press on play here, it rotates it in X axis. And because it's not merged one, it doesn't look very fancy, and you can also choose the different channel. Okay, so what we do from here, we merge the channels. So we had red and we had green. Okay, now we have this composition. And although the red does not look very, very cool, we proceed now with the formation of this 3D project. So again, we have the same settings. So you press OK, and you should wait until it's over. Okay, now we have the 3D image. So by rotating it, you can see the colocalization of these two channels, I mean the cell wall and the chloroplast. So if you press on this button, so let's make it full screen, and it actually shows you where especially you see the chloroplasts. So they are inside these cells. And this is just the representation of the strengths of the ImageJ. So by having only the Z-stacks, you could recreate the positioning of the cell structures and obtain this cool 3D image. Of course, it's not the only thing that you could have. So let's say that we have the experiment 7, which was the last week's tracing. Of course, because of the sizes of the pictures, it might take a lot of time to process them, so you will need to wait a lot, especially if your PC is not powerful enough. Okay, so now the file is open. What you want to do, you want to identify the one that moves a lot. Okay, so I guess this guy here moves a lot, but the thing is, here we have 180 images that we need to track, and we want to reduce the number of ticks to make. So what we do, we go to image, and since it is the stack, we could kind of create a hyperstack. Hyperstack is stack of stacks, okay? In this case, we create channels. So what we do, so here you have the number of frames or images, and they are 180. So let's say that we want to reduce it 3 times. So if we have 3 channels, so this initial stack will be divided into pieces of 3 stacks of 3 images, and the image J will assume them to be the channels. Okay, so what happens, we actually have images in the stack. Okay, so this is the usual stack, and now we want to create a hyperstack of it. So we say that we have 3 channels in this stack, and ImageJ will make these pieces of 3 channels, and it will create 3 channel as the single piece of the stack. Okay, now we will have the so-called hyperstack. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So now we have, instead of 15 frames, we would have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 frames, and each frame will be created with 3 different channels. Okay, so we kind of increase the speed of the work. Instead of clicking 15 times, we will click only 5 times. Okay, so this is the stack. Again, the stack is, and the hyperstack is the stack of stacks. Okay, so what happens here? In the settings, we choose 3, and since now we reduced the number of frames, we should calculate how much. So 180 divided by 3 is 60. It feels like 60 is still too much, so let's make 4 here, and 180 divided by 4 is 45. So you don't want to have it colored, you want to have it grayscales, so you just press on OK. And now, instead of these 180 frames stack, we would have 45 piece hyperstack with 3 channels. Okay, so of course in this case we reduced, not 3 channels, actually 4 channels. So we reduced the number of clicks we need to make. So what we do next, we choose plugins, then go tracking, manual tracking. And here you should press on this add track. And now we actually started tracing. So if I remember right, this one is the vesicle that we want to track. So you press on it, and actually you straight away obtain the table of the positions of this single vesicle. So every time you press on this vesicle, you will have a new entry here, and it will tell you a lot of stuff. So it will tell you the number of the track. So here it will appear as number one. Then you have slice number. So since we have four channels, so when we were doing the hyperstack, we chose five channels. Then we will go with the increment of four. So 1+4, 5, 5+4, 9, 9+4, 13, etc., etc. So in this case, of course, it's much easier. Then we have the positioning. So we have the X and Y coordinates and the distance, how much it traveled from the previous one. So the distance goes in pixels, and it also calculates the velocity. Since in the initial stack we had 2 seconds per frame, then we increase it to 4 times 2, so 4 channels goes as seconds, right? So now between the slices in the lower part, we have 8 seconds, not 1 second, not 2 seconds. So that's why you will need to adjust this velocity afterwards. And also you have the pixel value, which shows the grayscale. Okay, so we should continue with the clicking. So we need to click 45 times. Okay, and in the end you will see the whole pass that was made by this vesicle. Of course, in the different setup, the vesicle will move through the whole cell and you will clearly see it. But here you can actually see the whole path. Okay, so this is how you are doing the tracking. And you could also see the distance traveled by this vesicle. Okay, so how you do the distance? You just sum up everything in this column and obtain the whole distance in pixels. Okay, so after that you could export it, so save it as the CSV file, for example. So we have the standard CSV, so you click on it and you save the track. From here, if you're going to choose another vesicle and you don't want to save this one, you just click on delete track number. If you have a lot of tracks, by adding the track, you could choose whichever you want to delete or delete all. So this is how to make stacks. I also shown the 3D project, and I guess that we could stop here. So I also need to tell you that the macros, for example, is for automation of your work. So let's say you have 100 of the images to work with, and it is actually the same pattern of the stuff that you do for each of the image. So let's say we have the images here and you drag and drop them here, okay? So let's say I start with this one. So I opened this file and I want to start with the changing of the brightness. So you press on record here and you start with the manipulations. So let's say you open these brightness and contrast, and you really want to increase the brightness of these nuclei. So you set it to 50,000 and it appears like this entry here. So first you run the brightness and contrast and then you set it as minimum and maximum. After that you're going to press apply. So it applies the LUT and lookup table is how you see the image. So this is the enhancement that you perform on each of these images. So after you record it, the stuff that you need to do, so open the brightness and contrast, set it to the maximum value and then apply it. You press on create and from here you can run it. So instead of pressing every time on these brightness and contrast and setting up the 50,000 then applying the LUT, I can do it easier now because I have the macros. So here I have the unchanged image, so I press run and it applied everything for me. So you can check it by pressing shift C and it was applied and it stretched the histogram already. So now 65,000 is my 50,000 on the initial image. And to see it, you can reopen this file. And here you can see everything darker than on this one because we already applied this 50,000. Okay, so this is how macros works. And other stuff that you could do is you could create the plugins yourself. So you could use JavaScript if you know it. By the way, in the ImageJ, not the Fiji one, you could also use Python, Java, and other languages. So it's really easy to write the scripts. So you write the script, for example, to open all files in this folder, then perform some kind of actions on them, then save them and quit. Okay, so close the image. So this everything can be written in scripts of JavaScript for Fiji and Python plus Java in ImageJ. Okay, so this is how powerful it is, how easy it is to work with, and actually if you really want to be a very valuable person in the lab, you should know how to use the ImageJ or Fiji. Okay, so what we have to see the last is how to combine everything. So let's say we have these three images and they show different channels. So TMRA is the red, Hecht is blue, and DIOC in yellow. So what we could do, we could go coloring, so merge channels, and here choose TMRA, then blue your Hecht, and yellow your DIOC. So you press OK, but before you should check that it creates the composite and it keeps the source images. Why? I will show you. So now you see that, okay, so it's kind of messy, you don't want to see it. So what you do, you remove some background in red. So let's say that in red, here on this side in the information box, you will see the values that you need to cut. So it's around 6,000. So what we do, we cut everything that is below 6,000. So you press OK and now the background is better. Let's check other channels too. So it's blue, and 600 is mostly usual for your background, so you set it to 600. Now it became even darker. Now let's go to yellow and see how it behaves. So it's about 1000. Okay, now we have everything set up, and we can actually increase the brightness of some of these pixels. So let's say that the average is about 10,000. So for increasing, we go 24,000 for yellow, then for your blue we could go again 24, and for red it's the same, 30,000. So this is the auto correction, but auto correction of the maximum values. Okay, so now you can clearly see that we have the nuclei and something stained with TMRE and DIOC, and very dark background. So this is a cool image. So let's say that I want to have it kind of changed to RGB. So now I have RGB, so it's not this dark anymore, so I can't move like this and change the channels. So I only have one picture here and everything in RGB. Okay, so what else I want to do? I want to have the scale bar, and let's say I want it white without the background. Okay, so what else? I want to create the stack now, and let's keep it in the stack. And now I have a stack of images, so four images now. And as you can see, it combined all the images that were open at that moment. So what I want to do now, I want to create the montage. And from here, you can see the usual settings dialog window, and you choose the number of columns. So I want to be squared, so 2x2. Scale factor, I want to see them all as the original files. But if you want to rescale, let's say 25% of the previous size, okay? So first slide, last slide goes in the direction 1, 2, 3, 4. So the left bottom will be 4, the right top will be 1. So I also want border, which is 5 pixels, and I want to label my slices. Okay, so you press OK, and now you see this very cool image here, and it labels the composite, the Hecht, Okay, I can't move like usual. Okay, so we have the names of our channels. We could clearly see how they look, but of course they are not enhanced. That's why they are quite dark. And we have the composite here. So because I did not save the changes in my RGB, the scale does not look like it should look. So let's put the scale here, and of course because it's scaled to my initial measurements, it now changed 40 appropriately, so it's 1/4 of this line. So let's say I want 10, it's okay. So here is how you work with the composition and montage, for example. So this is the end of today's lecture. Thank you all. I would recommend that you go to Fiji site and read about the most used plugins, so you get familiar and you actually use them in your practice. Okay, goodbye all.